So we were on this slide last time on Monday. You were talking about network security. One way to attack a computer is to cause a buffer overflow. So one can write a program that will purposely cause a buffer overflow. When the buffer overflow happens, the stack overflows, and the routines will not find a proper return address, and they might end up at a place where the hacker has put his program, and so some code will be executed that was not meant to be executed. So that is one of the methods of causing these attacks. Another method is what we call distributed DDoS attack. DDoS is denial of service. Basically, what people do is they distribute their programs free over the internet, and those programs have viruses in them. And once they have virus, once they're installed on your computer, they can control from their computer. And so this is called what we call botnet. Botnet, B-O-T, botnet. So they sell the services for the botnet, then people buy those services. And so advertisers buy services, for example, and using botnet, they can have the computers do anything, including sending email, attacking a computer, attacking a website, and whatnot. So basically, a denial of service attack happens when millions of computers suddenly send requests to one server. That server gets over flooded, the site comes down, it could be Facebook, it could be YouTube, it could be, you know, Amazon, whatever, right? And so that thing happens. In fact, there is a program called Trino that you can download somewhere on the internet, and that basically allows you to do this kind of attack. There's another program which allows you to do this kind of attack. So anyway, so these are all the things that we talk more detail in network security class, which is taught once in 2 years, and it is being taught this year, right before this class. Anyway, that brings us to almost the end of this chapter. Just a little bit of history. Internet was started back in 1961 the concept of packet switching was in the PhD thesis of Kleinrock, who is a professor now at UCLA. So he wrote a PhD thesis saying that if we had packets, maybe we can do things better, and so on and so forth. Then in 1964, a report was written that military should use packet switching and not the circuit switching. And in 1967, the Advanced Project Research Agency, which is actually part of the military, they funded a project to start a network, first network, 1967. That was called ARPANET. That ARPANET in 1969 became operational, and the first request for comment was issued. So what is a request for comment? Basically, so a small group was formed of four universities working on this, and whenever they wanted to have an idea, they would write it on a piece of, on a memo, and then send it out to everybody. So it was called request for comment. I want to see whether you like this idea or not. And that has stayed. So even today, you can get RFCs. So today, we do it in an organization called IETF, Internet Engineering Task Force. And if you go there, you will find RFC number 842, RFC number 5023, RFC number 6000 something. And so we people in networking, when we talk about these things, they say, well, look up RFC such and such. And you go and look up that RFC from IETF. That is still continues from 1969. And so everything is, all the standards in the internet are documented in RFCs. Internet actually has changed quite a bit. And this is actually not from the book. This is some of our own research work. Basically, the first thing is that the internet one was the original internet, where basically everything was known to everybody. So when the universities started working together, they assumed that everybody knows what is the link between computer A and computer B and computer B and computer C, so we can find the optimal path. Right? That stayed until 1989. In 1989, the internet became public, in the sense that NSF said, now we are not going to, anybody can use it. Anybody in the business can use it. So when people started using, and AT&T got into the business of providing services, they said, we are not going to tell you what speed links are. Because they don't want to disclose, for example, AT&T will not want to disclose to Verizon that we have links of 10 megabits or, you know, 1 megabit or 100 megabits. Right? That's private information. So the whole internet was changed then, and the routing was changed. Instead of optimizing the routing, routing became more policy-oriented. So these things became black boxes. So the network became a concatenation of lots of black boxes. And then now it is changing again. What is happening now in 2009, it says, but basically that is the current research topic that we are working on, is that not only these are black boxes, the network, but even the hosts are black boxes. So what happens is, if you want to do something, you go to Amazon and you say, give me 2,000 computers. And you can rent 2,000 computers just like that. And then after 1 hour, you say, gone. You know, I don't need them anymore. And you can release them and so on and so forth. This is called cloud. So you can rent a cloud. And so this is what is happening on the hosts, are clouds. And what is happening inside the cloud is not really available easily to other people. And then the data and the users are already a cloud in the sense that nobody wants to tell you how many users are in their organization. So there's a lot more, the internet is becoming a lot more closed in that sense. It was very open in the beginning. Everybody knew the whole thing. Now only some people know about their network, and now some people only know about their computers and their networks and their users. So it has gone through three generations. So let's see. Now this is all from the book. And the book is talking about that up until 1990, basically, we were working on networking. I started working in networking in 1978, but nobody really noticed us. Nobody knew what is networking. Nobody in our company even noticed us, because our company was digital equipment, and digital equipment business was to selling computers. Networking was just a side thing. But 1990, suddenly something happened, and that is what happened was in 1990, HTML came in. HTML came in, and we'll talk about that in the next lecture. That is a web page, right? So Berners-Lee, who was not even a computer scientist, he was a physicist, physics person, physics researcher. He came up with this idea of having a web page. And that just broke the basically networking, brought networking into picture. And then Netscape formed a company to write web servers and so on and so forth. And 1994, every university was looking for people to teach networking. I was working for Digital. I got a call from Ohio State University saying that, you know, we need a professor, please apply. I said, no, I don't have a resume. I said, no, come on down, just anyway. So there was a big demand suddenly for networking in 1994. And then since then it has gone up and up and up. And as I said in the very first lecture today, any company that is making money today is a networking company, whether it is Google, whether it is Facebook, whether it is Apple. Okay? So today, I mean, networking, you cannot live without networking. In 2007, 500 million hosts, everything goes over the internet, voice, video. Now we have P2P applications such as BitTorrent and Skype and PP Live. Then we have video applications, YouTube, gaming, wireless mobility. So many things about networking that we need to learn about. So some of the key things that we will need coming up. First is IP. I'm going to use the word IP throughout, and you should know what IP is. IP is Internet Protocol. That is layer 3. Yeah, go ahead.
Can you lower the mic a bit, volume a bit?
I will, actually, this is what I will do. The reason I have microphone is so that my throat doesn't hurt, so that I don't have to speak loud, right? So I will speak slower. If I get too high, then let me know. That will help my throat. Because after two lectures, I have to get lecture before this class, and then this lecture, my throat gives up. So, okay, hopefully. Thank you. So IP is Internet Protocol. And IP addresses, all of you have seen. When you say IP config or TCP, IP, anything, then you see these addresses, which are 125.36.47.23. Have you seen that? Right, all of you? So that is your IP address. And you have seen the names. IP names are like scorpio.cec.bushtel.edu or ibm.com or google.com or something like that, right? Those are the names. So we will use those names. Those are actually what we call DNS, domain name system names, DNS names. And for the first 10 or 15 years, DNS did not exist. And so we just, only thing we had was numbers. Then 10 or 15 years later, we realized that numbers are very difficult to remember. And we could not remember that 128.27 is Google or something, or you know, or even Bushtel. So we said, no, we should put the names and then something should translate it. So we added DNS. And then IETF is the Internet Engineering Task Force. I have mentioned it many times in the class today and before. So IETF is where we go every 3 months or 4 months, we meet. About 5,000 people get together. And they talk about, you know, in maybe 100 different rooms, 50 people in each room talk about different issues. Some people are working on mail systems, some people are working on security, some people are working on how to send voice. So there are many, many groups. And that is where the standards come out for related to related to internet. And then they write the results are documented in the RFCs. Okay? All right. So your third homework is find the IP address of your computer. All right? There is a command called ipconfig. Write it down if you don't, I have never used it. ipconfig, ipconfig, no space. For Mac, it is ifconfig. Right? We just execute that command in a DOS box or somehow, and then you will get your IP address. Find the IP address of google.com. How do you find the address of google.com? You say ping. P-I-N-G and then www.google.com. And it will tell you the address of that computer. Then you want to measure the delay. For delay, you say trace route, trace RT, T-R-A-C-E-R-T. Yeah. You could measure the delay with the ping too. Yeah, okay, all right. So ping will tell you the delay, that's sufficient. Trace route will tell you the delay to every hop, and it will tell you all the hops along the way, which might be too much. So that's fine. So these are some of the fundamental commands that you really need to know as we go along this course. And most of these commands will be executed inside a DOS box. Here, DOS is the disk operating system. Command prompt, right? And so you need to know how to get the screenshot. So either you can write down with hand or something, but I think better to just, you know, do Alt print screen. That puts the window into a clipboard, and then you can paste it into a Microsoft Word as a picture, and then print it out and submit it. Right? Everybody can do that? Everybody wrote down the commands I said? ipconfig, ping, that's it, two commands. You probably have used it already. How many people have used ping before? Okay, well, I asked who didn't use it, so. Everybody has done ping, so everybody knows the IP addresses, and so that's not a problem. Okay. That brings us to the end of this lecture. And so these are the five summary points of this big chapter, 63 slides. First summary point is that the common medium is UTP. What is UTP? Unsealed twisted pair. And then wireless and fiber, you've submitted the homework number 1A, so you know already that. Internet, what is internet? Internet is a network of networks. All right, so WashU has a network. Amazon has a network, IBM has a network, and the internet is the one that connects all of these. And therefore, we can define the networks as enterprise networks, access network, and core networks. So, can somebody give an example of what is an enterprise network? Huh? Vashu has enterprise network. What is an access network?
Starbucks.
Starbucks, he says Starbucks, yeah. So anything that goes from the subscriber to the carrier is called access. And the core network, what is a core network? AT&T's inside network is core network, right? All right, then the performance delay. Then we talked about the delay, throughput, and loss rate. Now the delay was, we talked about the circuit-oriented delay and the packet-oriented delay. In packet-oriented, we had four kinds of delays: processing, nodal delay, which we didn't talk about, queuing delay, and the processing delay we did not talk about. But we talked about the transmission delay and the propagation delay. And there was homework 1B for that, right? I forget which one. Then we talked about the throughput and the loss rate, all right? And then protocol layers, then we talk about the ISO layer. So how many layers are there?
Seven.
Now, TCP does not have seven layers, but whenever we talk about applications in TCP IP, we say it is layer seven, all right? So whenever I say layer seven, even though TCP IP does not have seven layers, application is layer seven. Whenever I say layer four, what is that protocol? Anybody remembers layer four? TCP or UDP. Layer 3, IP, and layer 2 is Ethernet. So we use these words very often, layer 2, 3, 4, 7. There is no 5 and 6. As I said before, 5 and 6 were designed in OSI but never really implemented anywhere. So we just use 2, 3, 4, and 7. Oh, coding example you already did. So you got the handout for that today. So that does finish this chapter.